Hello students, welcome to Prep Guru. So in our video one, we had discussed about the advent of Europeans into India as part of our modern Indian history syllabus. Today we will start with our discussion on the later Mughals. Okay, just have a look at the, you know, whatever information which is being displayed on your screen. So, later Mughals are the ones who ruled after the death of Aurangzeb. Okay, they were, number one, Bahadur Shah I or Shah Alam. He was fondly called as Shah Alam I. He ruled between the year 1707 to 1712. He was called as Shahi Bekabar, that is heedless king. Okay, and then you had Jahandar Shah ruling between 1712 to 1713. Zulfikar Khan was his PM and he was the de facto ruler. In the year 1712, jizya was permanently abolished from India under the rule of Jahandar Shah. Then you had Farooq Siyar ruling between the year 1713 to 1719. Sayyid brothers were the de facto rulers under the Farooq Siyar regime. So you see, rather than the kings, it is the prime ministers who have become more powerful in comparison to the kings. Okay. After Farooq Siyar, there was Muhammad Shah Rangila, who ruled between the years 1719 to 1748. He was a pleasure-loving man. He was a Kathak dancer, Indo-Persian dance. Burhan-ul-Mulk and Nizam-ul-Mulk were the powerful officers of Muhammad Shah's reign. Burhan-ul-Mulk belongs to Turani faction. Nizam-ul-Mulk belongs to Turani faction, that is the Central Asian Sunnis. Burhan-ul-Mulk left Delhi in the year and founded the Awadh Kingdom with Faziabad as capital, and later the capital was shifted to Lucknow. Then in the year 1724, Nizam-ul-Mulk founded the Nizam state in Deccan. Mentioned as Aurangzeb, but it is Aurangabad. Please correct this. Initially, Aurangabad was the capital of Nizam, and later its headquarters was shifted to Hyderabad. Nizam-ul-Mulk was earlier the Subedar or governor of Deccan twice. Disintegration of the Mughal Empire was rapid now. So as the disintegration of the Mughal Empire was rapid now, that is why these people, the earlier governors under the Mughal rule, were founding their own empires, okay, parting away from Mughals. In the year 1739, Nadir Shah invaded India. He is also called as Napoleon of Iran, and he plundered India. The loot was worth of 70 crores. Okay, he took away India's peacock throne and also Kohinoor diamond. 1739, Nadir Shah invaded, took away the peacock throne and the Kohinoor diamond. Then between the years 1748 to 1750, Ahmad Shah ruled India. Imad-ul-Mulk was his wazir and he was the de facto ruler. Ahmad was blinded and put into prison by Imad-ul-Mulk. His prime minister had put him into prison. Then you had Alamgir II ruling between 1754 to 1759. Alamgir II was made the ruler by Imad. Later, he was killed by Imad and his body was thrown in river Yamuna, Alamgir II. Then you had Shah Alam II ruling between the years 1759 to 1806. The first 12 years, he was away from Delhi due to Imad's fear. He was taking shelter in the Awadh state ruled by Burhan-ul-Mulk. By this time, Mughal Empire shrank to a few kilometers, that is from Delhi to Palam. That was a sorry state of the Mughal Empire. Then Akbar II ruled between 1806 to 1836. He was a pensioner and was in deep financial crisis. See the glory Akbar won, okay, who was one of the mightiest rulers of India. And now see the way Akbar II, how he has become a pensioner and was in a deep financial crisis. He sent a representative to England to enhance his pension. That is, Dr. Raja Ram Mohan Roy was sent on his behalf. But there was hue and cry in Bengal as Raja Ram Mohan Roy, a Brahmin, was to travel overseas. He was socially boycotted because of this case. Ram Mohan Roy was the first modern man of India who wrote an epitome of, who was an epitome of rationality and reason. He traveled to England and passed away in Bristol in the year 1833. Ram Mohan Roy's tomb is in England only. He passed away in Bristol and in England, and his tomb is still present over there. Then Bahadur Shah Zafar. He ruled between the years 1837 to 1857. His authority was confined to the Red Fort in Delhi. He was a great Urdu scholar. Under his pen name Zafar, he wrote many poems and shayaris. In the 1857 Sepoy Mutiny or Revolt, Sepoys were Indians serving under the British Army. Hudson had suppressed the revolt in Delhi and massacred the entire family of Bahadur Shah. Bahadur Shah was sent to Rangoon as prisoner, and there he died a sad man, year 1862. Having discussed about the later Mughals, now let us try to analyze the British conquest of India. The British conquest was facilitated by disintegration of Mughal Empire, especially after Aurangzeb's death in the year 1707. It began in 1757 with Bengal, and till 1857, the imperial expansion continued till the conquest of 1856. 50% of the conquered Indian territory is called as British India. In the remaining 50% of territory, there were 563 princely states. Lord Hastings was the Governor General of India between the years 1813 to 1823, who conquered three princely states. The British neither conquered nor ruled entire India. Also note that the Telangana region never came under the British rule. The English East India Company had conquered 500 princely states, that is more than 50% of India. That is the quantum of British conquest. So now let us get into the details of the conquest of Bengal. Bengal consists of Bengal, Bihar, and Odisha, the present day Bengal, Bihar, and Odisha. It is the most prosperous province of Mughals due to the trade, communication, and location of industries. In the year 1717, the governor Murshid Quli Khan made Bengal an independent kingdom after Aurangzeb's death in the year 1707. So after Aurangzeb's death, the governor Murshid Quli Khan made Bengal as an independent kingdom. That is due to the disintegration of Mughal empire, which commenced with the Bengal. Then in the year 1756 to 1757, Siraj ud-Daula came into conflict with British in the Battle of Plassey. Okay, in the year 1757, the Battle of Plassey took place between the British and the Bengal ruler, Mr. Siraj ud-Daula. So what are the reasons for the Battle of Plassey? The dispute, number one, disputes over forts and fortifications. European merchants started building forts. This has caused uneasiness in Siraj ud-Daula. They replied that it was for security reasons. However, he asked them to demolish the forts, and all Europeans except the British had demolished them. Then, misuse of dastaks. In the year 1717, Farooq Siyar gave a farman. A dastak is a chit or a certificate issued and signed by the governor of Bengal, certifying that the cargo belonging to the English East India Company is eligible for exemptions of customs tax as per the 1717 Farman of Farooq Siyar. The dastaks were being misused by English East India Company. Example, they used to sell the dastaks to local businessmen. Okay, this privilege which was given by the Farrukh Siyar was being misused by the British. Siraj-ud-Daula was surprised that despite doing good business, no money is being accrued in the royal treasury of Bengal. Thus, Siraj-ud-Daula instructed officials not to honor any dastak. Number three, British involvement in court intrigues and gave shelter to the rebels. The capture of St. Fort William and the Black Hole tragedy. This led to Drake, who was the governor during this time. The captured British officers were locked in a small room for a few hours by Siraj-ud-Daula. So Siraj-ud-Daula, he was infuriated by the acts of British, by such as the acts of fortification, misuse of dastaks, and various other activities which undermined his authority. So he had captured St. Fort William, okay, and this led to a Black Hole tragedy where the captured British officers were locked up in a small room for a few hours, and 130 British officers were killed, and only 16 survived. Mir Jafar, the Prime Minister of the Senapati, had joined hands with Robert Clive, the British official. Thus, in Battle of Plassey was not a great battle but a betrayal, as told by many historians. Though British won the Battle of Plassey, they took over Bengal in the year 1772. Till 1772, they were indirectly controlling Bengal. So that's how, because of the intervention of Robert Clive and because of the betrayal of Mir Jafar, Siraj-ud-Daula was defeated in the Battle of Plassey. Then Mir Jafar was kept on the Bengal throne between the years 1757 to 1760. Favors done by Mir Jafar to the East India Company were free trade in all the three Subas of Bengal, namely Bihar, Odisha, and Bengal. 1.74 crore was given as compensation to the English East India Company. And also, a huge amount was given to individual officers of the company. Robert Clive alone earned £2 million. Also, 24 paraganas in Bengal had been given to the English East India Company. Mir Jafar was slowly getting dissatisfied with the excessive interference of the English East India Company in daily affairs. So, Mir Jafar started making friendship with the Dutch. In the Battle of Bedera in the year 1759, the Dutch were defeated and expelled from India, which we already discussed. So, in the year 1760, Mir Jafar was dismissed by the British. In his place, Mir Qasim was kept on the throne and he ruled between the years 1760 to 1763. He gave three districts, namely Chittagong, Midnapur, and Burdwan to English East India Company. He shifted the capital of Bengal from Murshidabad to Mohir in Bihar so as to evade excessive British interference. Mir Qasim shifted the capital from Murshidabad to Mohir. So the British, infuriated by this act of Mir Qasim, dismissed him. Mir Jafar was once again brought to power, but he was suffering from leprosy. The tripartite alliance was formed between Mir Qasim, the deposed ruler of Bengal, Shuja-ud-Daula, that is the Nawab of Awadh, 3 crore rupees was promised for him in return for his support, and Shah Alam II, the Mughal emperor, who was promised Bihar in return for his support. Thus, in the year 1764, the Battle of Plassey was taken place, where the British forces were held by Hector Munro, who defeated the tripartite alliance. Okay, in the year 1765, the Treaty of Allahabad was concluded between Robert Clive and the tripartite alliance, namely Shuja-ud-Daula of Awadh, Mir Qasim, Shuja-ud-Daula, and Shah Alam II. So this Treaty of Allahabad was concluded between Robert Clive and the losing parties. Dyarchy was introduced thereafter, after the Battle of Buxar and the Treaty of Allahabad. Dyarchy was introduced in Bengal, that is a dual system of government. The administration of Bengal was divided into Diwani and Nizamat. The Diwani, or the revenue administration, was taken over by the English East India Company. The Nizamat, or the law and order, was given to the Nawab of Bengal. money generating department was given by the British, but money spending department was given to Nawab, is what most of the historians observe. In this way, the Nawab was existent, but he did not have any substantial powers. This led to anarchy in the administration of Bengal. One third of the population of Bengal died due to famine, which can be said as a man-made famine, in the year 1770 due to administrative anarchy in Bengal. This shows the very sorry state into which Bengal was pushed to because of this British policy of diarchy. In the year 1772, Warren Hastings, the governor of Bengal, had abolished the diarchy system by taking away the Nizamat powers from the Nawab. The Nawab was dismissed and pensioned off. So Warren Hastings in the year 1772 had abolished diarchy and he had clipped the powers of the Nizam. He had clipped the powers of the Nawab of Bengal, and also he was sent away as a pensioner. The British took complete control of Bengal in the year 1772 because they were vexed with this, bickerings with the Nawabs. The British, though, did not take direct control of Bengal in 1757 itself, as English East India Company was accountable to the British Parliament. They were scared about an adverse reaction from the Indian people and was afraid about the British Parliament and the British government. But from 1772 onwards, the English East India Company had carried out rapid and aggressive imperial expansion. So that is how the British gained control over Bengal, and they had tried to expand their sphere of influence, which culminated by the year 1772. Now let us try to analyze the British conquest of the state of Mysore. Mysore was one of the provinces of the Vijayanagara Empire created by Sri Krishna Devaraya. Srirangapatnam was the provincial capital. Mysore was one of the provinces of Vijayanagara Empire, okay, and its provincial capital was Srirangapatnam. In the year 1610, Mysore became independent under the Nayaka of Wodeyar dynasty. Mysore was ruled by Wodeyars from the year 1610 to almost 1947, with short breaks in between. In the year 1761, when Krishnaraya I was the ruler, an officer called Haider Ali got the king dismissed and captured power. Haider Ali was a poor, illiterate man who started his career as a soldier and later rose to the level of Fauzdar of Dindigul. That is, he was enjoying the rank of governor. Haider Ali ruled Mysore between the years 1761 to 1782. Later, his son Tipu Sultan ruled between 1782 to 1799. He is called as Sher-e-Mysore or Tiger of Mysore. The Mysore kingdom had vastly expanded up to the Rayalaseema region by beating Nizam several times in the east and up to Kerala in the west under Haider's and Tipu's rule, with Srirangapatnam as its capital. What is the speciality of Srirangapatnam? The Kaveri River meets two local rivers and it is called as Triveni Sangamam. Okay, the Kaveri River meets two local rivers in this area of Srirangapatnam and it is called as Triveni Sangamam. Sridanganatha temple is also present here. It was built by the Vijayanagara rulers. So, four Anglo-Mysore wars were fought. The first Anglo-Mysore war was fought between the year 1766 to 1769. It was fought between Haider Ali and Lord McCartney, who was the governor of Madras. Finally, a status quo treaty of Madras was signed. However, in this first war of between first Anglo-Mysore war, there was advantage to Haider Ali. Then you have the second Anglo-Mysore war between the years 1780 to 1784. It was fought between Haider Ali and Governor General Warren Hastings. In the year 1782, Haider Ali died of cancer. Tipu Sultan succeeded and continued the war. The outcome of the second Anglo-Mysore war was the Governor of the governor generals lost their power to wage wars. Sorry, why did the governor general Warren Hastings wage a war with Hyder? Because at that time, the governors of Bengal, Madras, and Bombay lost their power to wage wars. It was only the governor general who could wage wars. The indecisive war came to an end, and the Treaty of Mangalore was signed between Tipu Sultan and the British. This also ended on a status quo. Treaty of Mangalore. First was the Treaty of Madras, second is Treaty of Mangalore. The third Anglo-Mysore War between the years 1790 to 92. It was fought between Governor General Cornwallis and Tipu Sultan. Cornwallis formed a tripartite alliance with the Marathas and Nizam to defeat Tipu. Tipu was defeated and a Treaty of Srirangapatnam was concluded. Almost 50% of the Mysore kingdom was taken away and was shared among the tripartite alliance. 3 crores of war indemnity was imposed by the British on Tipu. Also, the two sons of Tipu Sultan were taken away to Kolkata and he was guaranteed to pay 3 crores. He had to pay three crores to the British. Then you had the fourth Anglo-Mysore War in the year 1799. Tipu sought the assistance of British rivals, namely Napoleon of France and Zaman Shah of Afghanistan, but none of them came to his rescue, though they wanted to support him. The British were alarmed by this act of Tipu, so Lord Wellesley, the Governor General, targeted Tipu personally and eliminated him at Srirangapatnam. Mysore was occupied by British after 3 decades of struggle. Now let us see some details of Tipu Sultan. Tipu Sultan was a great administrator. He abolished the Jagirdari system. He abolished the Jagirdari system. He introduced new calendar, coins, weights, and measures. He promoted modern industries and trade. He sent embassies to many countries of Europe and Asia to improve the bilateral trade between Mysore and other countries. Sandalwood from Mysore and spices from Kerala were being exported from Mangalore port. He built a network of highways in Kerala. Okay. He also gave moral support to the French Revolution during the year 1789, which envisions his international vision. He celebrated the victory of French Revolution in Srirangapatnam and hoisted the revolution flag and planted the tree of liberty. He was secular in outlook. He offered expensive gifts to Lord Venkateshwara of Tirupati. Haider Ali minted Shivapati on the coins. Tipu donated gems and jewelry to Goddess Sharada. Later, they were looted by the Marathas. He started his day by listening to chantings of Sri Ranganatha temple. He wore a finger ring on which it was written Ram in Devanagari script. After the fourth Anglo-Mysore War, Wellesley had created a small state of Mysore and gave it to Krishnaraya III of the Wodeyar in 1799. The rest of the territory, 70%, was annexed by British. The British strategy was to send message to British Parliament and Indian people that English East India Company was an imperialist power and was fighting for the right cause, as they said that Haider Ali was an usurper of power. Then Krishnaraya III was made to sign the subsidiary alliance with the British. So the British had brought back the Wodeyar dynasty so that they wanted to give a legitimacy to their act of waging a war with Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan and decimating their power. So now let us try to understand what is subsidiary alliance. Subsidiary alliance is an imperialist scheme designed by Wellesley in the year 1798. Lord Wellesley designed this policy of subsidiary alliance, which came into force first time in the year 1798 with the state of Mysore. With the Wodeyars. The single objective was establishment of parity over the princely states and get princely states to surrender their powers without a war. Without the British waging a war, they had established their power over the princely states. The British would give complete protection to the signatory state from internal revolts and external aggression. The British would maintain subsidiary troops to give protection to the princely or native states. This army would be stationed in the native state itself and the entire cost of the troops maintained by the native ruler only, not the British. This heavy expenditure had led to many rulers disband their own armies. The cost of maintenance could be paid to the English either in cash or through territory. For example, Rayalaseema was given by the Nizam instead of cash. Of the princely state to British also happened under the policy of subsidiary alliance. A British resident, this led to interference in the internal affairs of the British. Few rulers who signed the subsidiary alliance apart from Mysore Wadiyar of Mysore were Nizam Ali Khan of Hyderabad in the year 1798 itself. So please note that, sorry, just a while ago I said that it was Wadiyar who first signed subsidiary alliance. Correct me, it was the Nizam of Hyderabad, Nizam Ali Khan, in the year 1798. He was the first ruler to sign the subsidiary alliance with the British because he had the threat from Marathas and Tipu Sultan. In the year 1799, Krishnaraya III of the Wadiyar dynasty of Mysore signed the subsidiary alliance. In the year 1801, Saadat Ali of Awadh signed the subsidiary alliance. In the year 1802, Peshwa Bajirao II of the Marathas signed the subsidiary alliance. So the Nizam, Wadiyars of Mysore, Sultans of Awadh, and the Peshwa of Maratha signed the subsidiary alliance subsequently. Now let us look at the British conquest of Marathas, annexation of Marathas. Shahu, who ruled between the years 1707 to 1749. He was a grandson of Shivaji. During this time, the rising of Marathas from the Himalayas to Vindhyas took place by various Peshwas. There were three Peshwas during King Shahu's reign. Balaji Vishwanath, who was the Peshwa who made the position of Peshwa hereditary. Balaji Vishwanath ruled between 1713 to 1720. He was the Peshwa between 1713 to 1720. Bajirao I ruled between 1720 to 1740. Son of Balaji Vishwanath and the greatest among all the Peshwas, Bajirao I can be said to be the greatest amongst all the Peshwas. He was the son of Balaji Vishwanath. Then you had Balaji Bajirao, who ruled between 1740 to 1761. He was also known as Nana Saheb. King Shahu died without a child. Hence, Balaji Bajirao or Nana Saheb became the dignitary and shifted the capital from Satara to Pune. So it was under the leadership or Peshwaship of Balaji Bajirao or Nana Saheb that the capital of Marathas was shifted from Satara to Pune. The Marathas plundered Delhi many times. They were powerful but failed to build a kingdom due to faulty economic and revenue policies. Bengal. The Marathas gained control of Bengal when Aliwardi Khan was defeated and the Marathas collected Chauth from Bengal. Odisha. Nizam was made to pay Chauth to the Marathas. The Wadiyars of Mysore were also plundered annually by the Marathas. The Karnataka or the Tamil Nadu region was plundered several times by the Marathas. The Maratha Peshwa, Balaji Bajirao or Nana Saheb, attacked Attock, that is northwestern Afghanistan, which was ruled by Ahmad Shah Abdali in the year 1761. Timur Shah, Ahmad Shah Abdali's son, was the governor of Attock, who ran away, okay, and he was expelled by Timur Shah. Ahmad Shah attacked Marathas with vengeance, and the third battle of Panipat was fought in the year 1761, which ruined the Marathas. With the third battle of Panipat of 1761, the Marathas lost a lot of economic as well as human resources. The two commanders of Maratha, namely Sadashivarao Bhave, the cousin of Peshwa Nana Saheb, and Vishwas Rao, the son of Peshwa, were killed. That is, it is said by a lot of scholars that two pearls, 27 gold mohurs were dissolved, that is 27 Maratha sardars were dissolved after this deadly battle of Panipat in the year 1761. Some of the popular Maratha families are Bhosles, who had their headquarters in Nagpur in Maharashtra, The Scindias of Gwalior from Madhya Pradesh, Holkers of Indore from Madhya Pradesh, Gaikwads from Baroda, Vadodara of Gujarat. Okay. So there was a question in UPSC. Why three empire-shaking battles were fought at Panipat? The first battle of Panipat was fought between Ibrahim Lodi versus Babur. Okay. The reason was the use of gunpowder by Babur was one of the reason why he could be victorious over Ibrahim Lodi. So with the first battle of Panipat, the Delhi Sultanate came to an end. Then the second battle of Panipat was fought between Hemraj and Akbar. With this, the Mughal Emperor Akbar came to power. The third battle of Panipat was fought between Ahmad Shah Ali and Marathas, and the Marathas' power collapsed due to the third battle of Panipat in the year 1761. What are the reasons for this? Why so many battles were fought at Panipat? The strategic location of Panipat is one of the reasons. Babur, Akbar and Ahmad Shah Abdali came from northwest to attack Delhi. Okay. And thus Panipat in Haryana is just 100 kilometers away from Delhi in the northwest direction. So that is about some of the significance of the region called Panipat. So with the third battle of Panipat, the fruits of third battle of Panipat in the year 1761 were enjoyed by the British, who were not connected to the battle. Because the Marathas' power weakened, this gave a chance for the British to expand their territorial as well as revenue ambitions in the Indian territory. The Marathas were humbled, and this ended the British conquest more easily. The Maratha power diminished, but Maratha rule continued later also. What is the difference between a battle of war? What is the difference between battle and war? A battle is something where the confrontation takes place at a single venue and the result is decided then and there itself. A war is a prolonged period of numerous battles. A war is a prolonged period of numerous battles. So that is about how the Maratha power came to an significant decline after the third battle of Panipat. In our next videos, we will discuss further about the conquest of British over Marathas, the conquest of Sindh, and the conquest of Punjab. Okay, thank you.